بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. We are still on the chapter of Al-Hudna and we move on to the next narration, 1142, from Al-Miswar ibn Makhrama and Marwan radiallahu anhuma. He mentions the narration where the Prophet والسلام, went out in the year of Al-Hudaybiyah. Remember, they were intending to perform the Umrah. And in the longer story, it mentions that the Prophet والسلام, made a sulh or a peace treaty with Suhail ibn Amr, one of the representatives of the Mushrikeen. And in this treaty, it said that Muhammad ibn Abdullah, and that's the Prophet, والسلام, has entered into a reconciliation or a peace treaty with Suhail ibn Amr, that they will not fight each other for 10 years, and that there will be peace between the two respective people, and that they will not harm each other and keep away. The original story here is in Al-Bukhari, and also Abu Dawud reported this particular narration. Muslim also reported a narration from Anas, and it mentions in that from the treaty, they agreed that whoever comes from the Mushrikeen to the Muslims, then the Muslims have to return him, but not the other way around. So whoever from the Muslims goes to the Mushrikeen, so he turns to Shirk, then the Mushrikeen are not obliged to return him to the Muslims. And so the companions were hesitant. They said, should we write this down, O Messenger of Allah? And the Prophet replied, Na'am, أَنَّهُ مَنْ ذَهَبَ مِنَّا إِلَيْهِمْ فَأَبْعَدَهُ اللَّهُ وَمَنْ جَاءَنَا مِنْهُمْ فَسَيَجْعَلُ اللَّهُ لَهُ فَرَجًا وَمَخْرَجًا. Yes, write it down, because whoever goes to the Mushrikeen from us, then may Allah remove him far away from mercy. But whoever comes to us from them, then Allah Jalla wa Ala will make for him a way out and grant him relief. As for this place, Al-Hudaybiyah, then this is an open place on the road to Mecca. Part of it is in the Haram and part of it is in the Hill. And this place is named after a well which is in it. So the well's name is Hudaybiyah. So the place is named after the well. So the story is well known. The Prophet ﷺ with his companions left from Medina to Mecca. He had a hadi with him, a sacrificial animal. He intended to perform the Umrah and he was in the state of Al-Ihram. The Mushrikeen, out of their jealousy and pride, they stopped the Muslims from entering Mecca. This was an extremely weird maneuver even by their standards, because normally the Mushrikeen of Mecca would welcome all the Arab tribes to Mecca to perform the Hajj or the Umrah. The Hajj and the Umrah were rituals even during the days of Jahiliyyah, so they still had remnants of the deen of Ibrahim alayhi salam. So anyway, the point is they would welcome the Hujjaj and the Mu'tamirin to perform the Hajj or the Umrah, because this would be beneficial for the economy, because it will grow their trade in Mecca. Remember, they were tradesmen. And so people coming in for the Hajj and the Umrah would have a chance to trade as well, and this would be fruitful for the economy of Mecca. So you would expect these mushrikeen to welcome all types of people to perform the Hajj and the Umrah, but here, strangely enough, they stopped the Muslims. Why would that be? It was out of pride. They did not want all the other Arab to say that the Muslims have overcome the Mushrikeen of Mecca. So in other words, the Muslim have had their way over the Mushrikeen of Mecca. So it was their pride and their reputation at stake. So this is why they felt it necessary to stop the Muslims from entering Mecca before the Muslims had sought permission from the Mushrikeen of Mecca. So this is why they agreed that the Muslims can perform Umrah the next year, only after the Mushrikeen have given the Muslims the green light, just to show the other tribes that the Mushrikeen are the big boss and the Muslims must follow their orders. So we find here that the Prophet and his 1,400 companions who were with him that year were turned back by the Mushrikeen. So they said that the Muslims could stay where they are for 3 days, but then they must return back to their homeland, and they can return to Mecca next year for the Umrah. They also agreed that there will be no war between the two factions for 10 years. And they agreed to this idea that the Muslims must return the Mushrik, but the Mushrikeen are not obliged to return the Muslim if the Muslim turns to Shirk and goes to the Mushrikeen. So it's skewed in favor of the Mushrikeen then. So even though you would think that the Mushrikeen would go away happy, It is the funniest thing of all that it is exactly this treaty which led to the conquest of Mecca, because the Mushrikeen are the one, funnily enough, who betrayed this treaty when they helped their allies against the allies of the Muslims. Hence the treaty was broken and the Muslims had every right to invade Mecca and help themselves. So just look how Allah Jalla wa Ala turns the plot of the Kuffar right against them. This is the amazing issue. But the main purpose of this narration is to inform you that the sulh, or the peace treaty, can take place between the Muslims and the Kuffar. And this does not mean that the Muslims are leaving off jihad in the way of Allah Jalla wa Ala. Rather, this only means that they are delaying the jihad. Also, it needs to be noted that the Treaty of Al-Hudaybiyah is an example of where the Qur'an makes a takhsis of the Sunnah. So with the Sunnah, we know that the Mushrik coming to the Muslims is to be returned back to the Mushrikeen. However, the Qur'an makes an exception here to those women who have made Hijrah from the Mushrikeen to the Muslimin, because the Muslim woman is not allowed to remain married to the Kuffar men. So returning them back to the Mushrikeen would mean that you're allowing the Muslim woman to remain married to her Mushrik husband. And that's not permissible. Allah Jalla wa Ala says in Surah Al-Mumtahanah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا جَاءَكُمُ الْمُؤْمِنَاتُ مُحَاجِرَاتٍ فَامْتَحِنُوهُنَّ اللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِإِيمَانِهِنَّ فَإِنْ عَلِمْتُمُوهُنَّ مُؤْمِنَاتٍ فَلَا تَرْجِعُوهُنَّ إِلَى الْكُفَّارِ لَا هُنَّ حِلٌّ لَهُمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحِلُّونَ لَهُنْ. O you who believe, when believing women come to you as emigrants, then you have to test them if they are truly believers. Allah knows best about their iman. If you know them to be believers, then you are not allowed to return them to the kuffar, because they, meaning the Muslim women, are not halal for the Mushrikeen men, and the Mushrikeen men are not halal for the Muslim women. This Treaty of Al-Hudaybiyah brought about many benefits, the greatest of them, of course, that it was the cause for the conquest of Mecca, and from there on, the conquest of the whole of Arabia, because after that year, many tribes from all across Arabia entered into Islam in hordes and groups, as Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا. And you saw the people enter into the deen of Allah in hordes or in groups. And also, it led, ultimately, people like Khalid ibn Walid and Amr ibn al-As and Abu Sufyan ibn al-Harith and Abu Sufyan ibn Harb and Abdullah ibn Abi Umayyah, from the leaders of the Mushrikeen, to convert to Islam. And Allah Jalla wa Ala helped and gave victory to his deen through these people. And also note that when the ayah in Surah Al-Fatih came down, Inna fatahna laka fatham mubina, we have granted you a manifest conquest. This came down shortly after the Treaty of Hudaybiyah and well before the actual conquest of Mecca. Now, the average person reading this ayah then would be thinking, how is the Treaty of Al-Hudaybiyah a conquest for the Muslims? It simply doesn't make sense, where this treaty is so blatantly skewed in favor of the Mushrikeen. How can you call this a conquest? But the average person does not know what will happen in the future. Allah Jalla wa Ala does know. And so he knew that it was because of this Hudaybiyah treaty that will lead to the conquest of Mecca, and that would be a manifest victory and conquest. And in Al-Bukhari, Al-Bara reports, he says that you people deem the conquest of Mecca to be the conquest, but we deemed the Bay'at al-Ridwan under the tree on the day of Hudaybiyah to be the real conquest. The Bay'at al-Ridwan is when the Muslims were stopped. So the Prophet took an oath of allegiance underneath a tree from the Sahaba that if it comes down to a fight, then none amongst you is going to flee. You would rather die, but you will not flee away. And the Sahaba gave this pledge of allegiance to the Prophet because there were some rumors being spread around that Uthman ibn Affan had been killed by the Mushrikeen. So if this was true, then it would be a declaration of war and the Muslims would have to go to war. So this is why the Prophet took this oath of allegiance from them, that are you committed or not? And all the Sahaba proved themselves that when push comes to shove, They were indeed committed and they gave the Pledge of Allegiance. And this is the Bay'atul Ridwan, the Pledge of Pleasure, because it earned the pleasure of Allah Jalla wa Ala. لَقَدْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ يُبَايِعُونَكَ تَحْتَ الشَّجَرَةِ Allah is pleased with the believers when they gave you the Pledge of Allegiance under the tree. Hadith 1143 from Abdullah ibn Umar رضي الله عنهما, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said, من قاتل معاهدا لم يرح رائحة الجنة وإن ريحها ليوجد من مسيرة أربعين عاما أخرجه البخاري. Whoever kills a kafir with a contract with the Muslims, he will not smell the fragrance of Jannah, even though its fragrance can be smelt or detected from a distance of 40 years. Al-Bukhari reported it. So we learn immediately from this hadith that killing a mu'ahad is a major sin because of this threat which has been given in the hadith. And killing a mu'ahad is definitely a breach of the treaty, and it is from the character of the Muslims to keep the treaty. In fact, even the mushrikeen Arab in pre-Islamic times were well known for keeping their treaty. So a Muslim should be even more worthy to keep to his word and to keep to the treaty. As for killing the mu'ahad with due right, then this is of course permissible. But what the hadith is talking about here is killing him without due right. We also learn from the hadith that Jannah has a fragrance which can be smelt from a distance of 40 years, meaning 40-year journey. So if the kafir is paying the jizya, then the Muslims have to refrain from him, but the contract can be broken if, for example, he does not obey the laws of the Sharia in the state. For example, he openly drinks alcohol, or if he kills another Muslim or openly commits a zina. What about the Majus? In the deen of the Majus, they're allowed to marry their mahram women. So for example, a man is allowed to marry his blood sister, and this is permissible in their deen. Well, the Sharia in this case will not object to it because it's permissible in their deen. They can do that. But if somebody does something which is haram in their deen, then this is a punishable act. Just like the Prophet punishing the Yahud for adultery. Or for example, if the Kuffar become highwaymen and they cut people off from their journey and rob them, or for example, if he is guilty of spying for the kuffar against the Muslims, then this will break off the contract and the life and the wealth of that kafir would become halal for the Muslims, just as if he was a harbi. And even if a kafir is giving shelter to a spy, then this will also break off his contract. Or for example, if he insults Allah Jalla wa'ala and the Prophet, this will also break off the contract. If this person whose contract has been broken has wife and children, then their contract will not be broken, just his will. So if a person becomes a harbi, then the imam has a choice what to do with him. He can kill him, or take him in as a servant, or he could just simply free him, or he could free him for a ransom. Although some scholars, like Ibn Taymiyyah, they say that if he insults the Prophet, then he has to be killed even if he repents. And in fact, the same ruling goes for a Muslim. Then Al-Hafidh says, Bab al-Sabq wal-Rami, the chapter of sabq and rami, which is shooting or shooting arrows. As-sabq is pronounced either as-sabq with a sukun on the ba, and that would mean coming ahead of someone else, like in a race, or you could pronounce it sabq with a fatha on the ba, and this would be the prize you win in the race. So the sabiq is the one who comes first, as in the statement, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ The first and foremost from the Muhajirin and the Ansar. So when it comes to competing in races, then this could be of three types. The first type is those types of competitions or races which are impermissible, regardless of the winner receiving a prize or not. The second type is those types of races or competitions which are permissible, but the winner is not allowed to receive a prize. And the third type is those types of races or competitions which are permissible and the winner is permitted to receive a prize. And when we talk about prize, we mean that, let's say if two people are racing and both of them put money in the pot and they say that whoever wins amongst us, he's going to receive the whole pot. So this would be a type of gambling. And so therefore the asl on this type of activity is that it is not permissible because it is from the maisir or gambling. And it is from gambling because one person is going to win at the expense of the other. And this is the simple hallmark of gambling. One person gains at the expense of the other. In a trade contract, both people gain. So trade is not gambling. So racing could be on foot, but it also can be using animals like horse racing. And if people are accustomed to using camels like they were in those days, then you can even have camel racing. What about racing of the dogs, where you just let them loose and they race each other? Is this type of racing allowed? Some may say no because the owner of the dog has no part to play. It's just the dog racing. And some others may say that it is permissible because there's nothing to say that racing the dogs is impermissible. It could even be beneficial because if you have a hunting dog, he needs to be fast at running. And so this could be a type of training to make him run fast. However, putting money on dog racing, as what happens nowadays often, then this is impermissible. This prize does not have to be a monetary prize. For example, two men, they race on foot, let's say a 100 meters race, and when one of them wins, the winner says to the loser, "You have to let me drive your car," let's say. Now, this is not a monetary prize, but still, this is not permissible because it is a prize for this race, and we have a situation where one person gains at the expense of the other. So here the winner will obviously gain at the expense of the loser. So again, this is a type of gambling. What about if kids have a race, young children, they have a race and the winner says to the loser that you have to give me a piggyback to the starting point where we started the race. This is your punishment for losing. Again, this is one person gaining at the expense of the other. However, if these are little young children, then we could allow this sort of thing because even though in principle it is haram, but we can say that when it comes to these types of activities, the lahu or the activities which distract you or some sort of entertainment activities, then it is permissible for children what is not permissible for adults. So, for example, you would find that it is permissible for children to use these action figures and dolls which have human faces. Clearly, having these human faces or animal faces is not permissible because angels do not enter a house in which you have such items. But for children, we can make this permission because it is from their nature to entertain themselves and to distract themselves. So for children, particularly, we can be flexible. And so we would allow images for them. And so similarly, over here, we would allow them to engage in this type of activity. From the hadith, which is coming up, we find that if you are performing the horse racing or the camel racing or competition pertaining to bow and arrow, then you can have competitions there and each person can put some money or whatever he wants into the pot and the winner takes the pot. So we're going to have a situation where one person gains at the expense of the other. Now, normally this is gambling, however, the Sharia does allow this. So this would be an exception to the general prohibition on gambling. Some scholars tried to get around this idea that this is gambling. They said that, okay, you can have these competitions, but they said that we need to have a third party who does not put any money in the pot. So we will have three people racing. Two of them put money in the pot, and the third one doesn't. Now, whoever wins takes the pot. And so, if the first person wins, then this would be at the expense of the second person, but not at the expense of the third, because he didn't put any money in the pot in the first place. And if the second one wins, this will be at the expense of the first person. But if the third person wins, then this would be at the expense of both the first and the second person. So, what we have here is a situation where the third person can never lose, but he can only ever win, if anything. And so, they say that this is not like the conventional gambling in which everybody puts money in the pot and everybody is guaranteed one of two things. Either he will win at the expense of the other or he will lose at the gain of the other. However, this is a weak opinion because you're trying to make halal gambling. This is the issue. It's a hila or a strategy or a trickery to make gambling halal. Rather, we simply say, as the hadith says, in accordance with what is apparent, that you cannot have any prize giving except for horse racing, camel racing, and archery. And this would be a clear exception to the general prohibition of gambling. So yes, it is gambling, but it is halal in this particular case. So what we are dealing with here is gambling. But you could have competitions in which you have members competing, and none of them put anything in the pot. Rather, the prize comes exclusively from the third party, who is not part of the race. And this is how many competitions are carried out. So you'll find that people don't put anything in the pot, rather, the prize comes from a third organization who is, let's say, organizing this competition event. Well, in a case like this, it is definitely not gambling, because you don't have a situation where one person wins at the expense of the other. So we say that if the activity involved is permissible and beneficial, then there's nothing wrong with this. So for example, if the activity is wrestling or some sort of martial arts event or racing, then these types of activities are good for your health, so they are beneficial. And so to put a prize in like this from the third party or the third organization who is not part of the actual competition itself, then we don't see anything wrong with that. As for if the actual activity is a useless activity which does not give off much benefit, so let's say, for example, computer games, the one who can beat the other in a computer game, he will win the prize, which is offered by an organization organizing this competition event, then here this is debatable, because playing computer games is not beneficial in and of itself. It is merely a lahu or a distracting activity simply for the sake of entertainment. It does not have any beneficial effects on your health, as opposed to, let's say, racing or martial arts and so on. So with this second scenario then, you could argue that this should not be done because you'll be encouraging these futile activities. So when it is asked, why did the Prophet ﷺ allow gambling in the events of the horse racing, camel racing, and archery? And the answer is that these are activities which are useful in jihad. And this is the book we are on, of course. We are on the book of jihad. And nowadays, not many people use horses and camels and archery for fighting, but it was used then, so there is no problem in us using analogy. And instead of using horses, you could have fighter jets. Instead of archery, you could have light machine guns or assault rifles, sniper rifles, and these types of items which take the place of archery. So we can say that those activities which help with jihad, then you can gamble in those. As for those competitions which are not allowed, neither by way of gambling nor by way of non-gambling, then these would be haram activities. So for example, who can rob the most people? Let's have a competition. No, this competition is haram. Or for example, playing backgammon or nard, these are dice games. And so dice games then are haram to be played. Because with this we have a particular text in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet forbade nard, and that is playing with dice. As for chess, then we don't have any particular evidence from the hadith, but we do have evidence from the statement of Ibn Umar. He said that playing chess is worse than nard. As for playing with dice or dice games, then the Prophet ﷺ said, this is like the one who puts his hand in the flesh of swine. So it's like eating flesh of swine. And of course that's haram. These types of activities don't have any benefit and they distract and waste a lot of time. And of course this is one of the reasons why khamr is made haram. Remember what Allah Jalla wa'ala says, that shaitan only wants to incite enmity between you and also hatred between you and to divert you away from the dhikr of Allah and from the salah. So will you then not refrain from these activities? So diverting you away from the remembrance of Allah is why khamr has been made haram. And so any activity which is extremely effective at diverting you away from the remembrance of Allah would take the same ruling as khamr. So this pertains to these addictive types of activities, because khamr without doubt is addictive, likewise gambling is addictive. So it's the addictive type of activities that we have to watch out for. Then you can have the third type, and this is a type of competition in which you are not allowed to gamble in it, but you are allowed to do it without gambling. And so these would be the permissible types of activities, but they do not have any benefit in terms of jihad. So, for example, running on foot, then you're not allowed to gamble in a race like this. So it mustn't be the case that every contender puts some money in the pot and the winner takes the pot. You're not allowed to do this. However, you're allowed to do it without the gambling element. Likewise, it would be permissible if you have contenders running and the prize is going to be given by a third person who is organizing the event but not taking part in the event, then this is also permissible, as said before, because there's no gambling involved in this. What about boxing? Boxing, the ulama say, is haram because the whole objective is to strike the face, and this goes against the hadith of striking the face. Likewise, boxing seems to be the only activity in which it is legal in the law of the land to give somebody a brain damage, because this is the whole danger with boxing, is that you are risking brain damage, and the one who gives you brain damage is probably going to earn a whole load of money. So this idea of striking the face goes against the Sharia. Otherwise, when it comes to wrestling competitions or martial arts competitions, then we say that this is permissible if it is done without gambling. And if we imagine that people would fight a war using martial arts, well, of course, we know nowadays they don't do that, but let's just imagine that this was the case, that people would go to war using martial arts without using the weaponry, then we would even say that gambling in these competitions would be allowed because it would help in jihad. But nowadays, there is a problem because people don't use horses for the jihad. And if we say that the gambling element was allowed for horse racing on account of jihad, then this illah or reasoning does not apply nowadays because horses are not used for jihad. So if that's the case, then would we not have to say that horse racing is not allowed if you are going to gamble and put money in the pot? So how do we argue? Do we say, no, we have a tax for horse racing, therefore we will stick to it regardless of whatever time period we are living in? Or do we say, no, we look at the reason why the gambling is halal, and so if the reason is there, the ruling is present, and if the reason is not present, the ruling therefore is not present likewise. We can take two options here, as we have suggested. This is similar to the Zakat al-Fitr. Back in those days, ash-sha'ir or barley would be the staple food of the people. But nowadays, in many places, it is not. So the question becomes, can sha'ir or barley be given as Zakat al-Fitr in those places nowadays where sha'ir or barley is not the staple food? Do we go with the text, which simply says, yes, the Prophet made it fard to give a sa' of food from tamar, dried dates, or sha'ir, which is barley? Or do we go with the underlying meaning, which says that the Zakat al-Fitr needs to be given from the staple diet of that land, whatever that diet may be? So you see here, there are two routes we can go down. Well, the situation of the Zakat al-Fitr is easier to decide because of the narration of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri in al-Bukhari, who says that the Prophet made it wajib to give the Zakat al-Fitr from the food. And our food in those days was tamar and sha'ir and zabib and aqid. Tamar, dried dates, zabib, raisins, sha'ir, barley, and aqid is dried cheese. So there, the illah or the reasoning is clearly given that it needs to be a food. So whatever is food can be given, and whatever is not food in that particular land cannot be given. But with the horse racing scenario, it is a little less clear. Do we go with the underlying meaning, or do we go with what is zahir or apparent from the wording of the narration? You can have two opinions and two options or two routes to go down. And the reason why this scenario is more difficult than the Zakat al-Fitr is because the illah for the gambling and horse racing being allowed is not stipulated in the text. It is something which is mustanbat or extracted by the ulama. But if we were to argue that it is impermissible to have the halal form of gambling for horse racing and archery and camel racing, then this would be an understandable opinion because the illah does appear to be the jihad activities. And we can simply replace them with things like fighter aircraft racing and competitions pertaining to firing guns, because this is what is used in warfare nowadays.
And this appears to be the better opinion. And Allah knows best.
So when we are talking about those competitions in which the competitors can gamble, so we'll take horse racing for example, then there are conditions which need to be met. The first condition is that the animal which is being ridden needs to be specified. So you must specify that I will be riding this particular horse, and you point to it so everybody knows which horse it is. Because if the horses are unknown, then this could lead to a dispute. Somebody might say, no, this is unfair, you are riding the fast horse, that's why you won, and so on. And also the rider himself needs to be specified. So you need to specify who the rider is. Because winning the race will depend on the quality of the horse, but it will also depend on the skill of the rider. And so if it depends on both the animal and the rider, then both need to be specified. Because both of these will have an effect on who wins the prize. And whatever has an effect on who wins the prize, this needs to be clearly specified so as to prevent any argumentation and enmity and hatred later on. Condition number two is that the horses need to be similar. So you cannot have a fat horse racing against a slender horse because the slender one is going to win. Some horses are well trained for racing, others are not. So the horses need to be of the same quality. Otherwise, the race will be unfair. And giving out a prize in an unfair race is obviously unfair. Is it a condition that both the racehorses must be males, so the males race against each other and the females race against each other? The answer is no, this is not a condition. The males can race against the females. Because normally with human races, you would have the females running against each other and the males running against each other, and it would be separate. But with horses and other animals who race, it appears that the gender does not make a difference. Similarly, if it is an archery competition, then the archer must be identified so as to avoid disputes, and also the bow and arrow must be identified as well, because you want them all to be of the same quality, both the weapon and also the one firing the weapon. They must be of similar quality, because obviously the point is we want to make this race or this competition fair. And especially when there's a prize at stake, we absolutely must make sure that it is all fair. And also from the conditions, the distance must be known. So the distance the horses are going to race must be known. And of course, this must be appropriate for the horse. So the race horses can run a longer distance. The ones who are not trained will run a shorter distance. Likewise with the archery event, the stronger archer is going to be able to shoot further. And the weaker ones will not be able to shoot as far, so the distance needs to be known. So these are conditions when the competitors are gambling. As for when the competitors are not gambling, for example, they are just running on foot, and this is an event in which you are not putting anything in the pot, then the matter is flexible. You can have a complete fatso running against a slim, fast runner. And there's no problem with that because it's not like somebody's going to gain at the other's expense. Or you could have a donkey running against a horse if you are not going to be putting any money in the pot. And all these conditions don't have to be met. Is it permissible for one of the competitors to retract from this competition if it is being done for a prize, meaning by way of gambling? The answer is that if he is on the losing end or he has a lower share, then it is not permissible for him to retract. So for example, if we have two people that put money in the pot, and after racing some events, person A has 60% of the pot and person B has 40% of the pot, then person A can retract because he is winning, but person B, who has 40% of the pot, he cannot retract because he is losing. And so he may just retract because he's losing, and we would not allow that. He could retract and cancel this gambling if the other person is content with it. But as for the person A, who is winning and he has 60% of the pot, if he wants to revoke this gambling, then he's allowed to do this because he's winning. So it's not like he's doing it because he's losing and he's a sore loser, but because he is winning, he can cancel this gambling event. And so everybody can take their money back. Let us take a look at these ahadith that we have in this chapter. Number 1144, the statement of Ibn Umar, he says that the Prophet conducted a horse race. Those horses who were slim, so they could run faster, They ran from Al-Hafya to Thaniyat al-Wada'. And as for those horses who were not slim, so they're not as fast runners, then they ran from Al-Thaniya to Masjid of Banu Zurayq. That's the name of the masjid. And Ibn Umar was from the participants in this horse race. Muttafaqun alayh. And Al-Bukhari adds that Sufyan al-Thawri said that from Al-Hafya to Thaniyat al-Wada' it is 5 amyal, and 1 mil is equal to 1600 meters in the metric units. And he says that from Al-Thaniya to the Masjid of Banu Zurayq it is 1 mil, so that would be 1600 meters. Number 1145. The statement of Ibn Umar again, he says that the Prophet conducted a horse race, and as for those horses who had completed 5 years of their life, he made the distance they would run a lot more than the other horses who were younger. The narration is sahih. So you'll remember what we were speaking about before. We said that the condition for conducting the horse race is that the horses must be known, the riders must be known, and the distances must be known, and also the horses must be similar. So the fast horses race amongst each other, and the slower horses race amongst each other. And this is exactly what we find in these narrations. The faster horses are running a longer distance, the slower ones are running a shorter distance, and they are running against horses of similar ability. And of course the distances are well known, because we don't want any disputes. If there is a prize at stake, so if gambling is involved here, we don't want any disputes occurring. Making the horses slim so they can run faster, so they have less load to carry, is permissible, even if it may cause the horses some difficulty because you're depriving them of some food, but the benefits outweigh the negative consequences. It's similar to how you might cut the hump of a camel to show that this is a sacrificial animal in the Hajj. It could cause some pain for the animal, however, this is done for a valid reason, and so it would be permissible. Otherwise, the general rule is that you are not allowed to cause any pain to the animal. In this narration, we see the fast horses, the slim ones, they are running 1,600 meters times 5, so that's 8 kilometers, and the slower horses, or the fatter ones, they are running 1.6 kilometers. We can take from this narration also a side benefit, that it is permissible to name a masjid after a particular personality. Because we find here that the masjid to which the horses were running was called Masjid Bani Zurayq, the Masjid of the Children of Zurayq. So this is a masjid named after someone.
Hadith number 1145. From Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, he says that the Prophet raced some horses. And as for those horses who had completed 5 years of their life, so these are the ones whose milk teeth have fallen and the wisdom teeth have grown. So with these horses, he made them run a longer distance. The narration is reported by Ahmad, Abu Dawood and Ibn Hibban and is sahih. This narration is similar to the previous one, which is to say that the faster and stronger horses, they run a longer distance, and the weaker horses run a shorter distance. And that makes sense because you do not wish to overburden any horse or any other animal, just like you do not overburden any other person. The texts of the Sharia speak quite a bit about horses. In the Sahih, the Prophet said that the horses have goodness attached to their forelocks up till Yawm al-Qiyamah. In the Musnad of Ahmad, authentically, the Prophet said that horses are of three types. Farasun lil-Rahman, the horse for Allah. Wa farasun lil-Insan, and a horse for the people. Wa farasun lil-Shaytan, and a horse for Shaytan. As for the horse of Allah, then it is the one you ride to fight in his way. As for the horse of Shaytan, then this is a horse used for gambling. So for example, these horse races that you see on television, people put money on them. This is all, of course, gambling and is haram. And as for the horse for the insan, for the person, then it is the horse he rides to earn a living, and it covers him from poverty. So this is as he rides out to go and earn a living. Nowadays, people use cars and buses and trains and so on. A higher population of horses is better, than other types of animals, such as mules. Authentically in Sunan Abi Dawood, the Prophet was given a mule as a gift, and Ali radiallahu anhu said, "O Prophet, why do you not cross a donkey with a horse so we can have more of these type of mules?" Because that's what a mule is, a cross between a donkey and a horse. And the Prophet replied to this suggestion, إِنَّمَا يَفْعَلُ ذَلِكَ أَلَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Only the ignorant people do this, because a higher mule population is no good. Mules are not as useful as horses. We want more horses. It's also worth knowing that people should not engage themselves in useless and futile activities, especially those which go against the murua, or goodly, manly character. Authentically in Sunan Abi Dawud, the Prophet saw a man chasing after a pigeon, and he said to this, "Shaytan yatba'u shaytana," a shaytan following a female shaytan, because this type of act is not in accordance with murua, which means dignified behavior.
Number 1146. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا سبق إلا في خف أو نصل أو حافر رواه أحمد والثلاثة وصححه ابن حبان. From Abu Huraira, the Prophet said, there is no gambling for a prize except in the case of camel racing or shooting the arrows or archery or horse racing. The hadith is sahih. We know the general rule that gambling is haram. So if you have a race and everybody puts some money in the pot and the winner receives the pot, then this is gambling. You could have a person who wins an extreme amount of money at the expense of others. And with gambling, sometimes you could win an extreme amount of money without making any effort. And certainly this leads to enmity and hatred between the people, which completely opposes the spirit of the Sharia. The Sharia intends to create brotherhood. And not just that, the gambling also is addictive and it takes you away from the remembrance of Allah Jalla wa Ala. However, this is an exception in this hadith. The Sharia makes this exception for a greater good. These three activities involved help in the jihad. So this type of gambling therefore is encouraged because it helps in jihad. So this is a greater good. This narration is the central or the pivotal narration in this chapter, because we find that gambling is not permissible except for these three types of activities. And by way of analogy then, all those types of activities which have a direct impact on jihad. So nowadays you could have firing guns and assault rifles and fighter jets and tanks and so on. So that would take the place of these three activities, because these three are not used in warfare anymore. But then if that's the case, then we said the debate comes in, are you allowed to gamble with these three activities now? The question is, do we go by the wording of the hadith or do we go by the extracted meaning of the hadith? And we say extracted meaning because this is what the scholars have extracted from the hadith, meaning the illah which they have extracted. The illah is not mentioned in the hadith itself. So it is something which is extracted or inferred. One might also include in this category competitions of knowledge, because when it comes to jihad, which is fighting in the way of Allah and seeking knowledge, then they do go hand in hand. Remember what Allah Jalla wa Ala says, that all Muslims must not go out to fight. There must be a party which remains behind to learn the deen, meaning to gain fiqh. So fighting and fiqh, they go hand in hand, because they both serve and support and raise the word of Allah Jalla wa Ala. And we know of the narration in At-Tirmidhi authentically, where Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu had a bet, a gambling bet, with a mushrik that the Rum would beat the Faris after a few years, which is what the Quran mentions in Surah Ar-Rum. The mushrik said, no, this prediction will not come true. Abu Bakr obviously said yes, it's in the Quran, therefore it must come true. They had a bet to decide who is correct. A few years passed and the Rum did not beat the Faris. So the mushrik came all happy and he said, look, you have lost the bet, give me my money. And so Abu Bakr went to the Prophet and the Prophet told him, this is what you do. You increase the money in the pot and you give the mushrik a few more years of delay. So in other words, give me a little more respite. And in return for you giving me this respite, I will increase the money in the pot. Thus, if you win, you win more. So this would be in favor of the mushrik, obviously. So this is what they did. And indeed, the Rum did beat the Faris, as the Quran predicted, and Abu Bakr won the bet. Now the point is, this is gambling, it's haram. But this was a case of knowledge. Thus it would suggest to us that gambling would also be permissible in competitions of knowledge. So for example, you have two people competing in an Islamic quiz. This is obviously pertaining to knowledge. And both of these competitors, they put some money in the pot. And they say whoever wins the quiz, he's going to take the whole pot. Now clearly somebody's going to gain at the other's expense, hence this is gambling. But it appears that in the case of knowledge competitions, just like in the case of a jihadi competition, this gambling is permissible. It encourages people to learn the deen. Hence this gambling serves a greater good. And it definitely would not distract you from the remembrance of Allah, because gaining knowledge is the remembrance of Allah. Likewise, training for jihad cannot divert you from the remembrance of Allah. Jihad is one of the greatest acts of worship. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah takes a very strict stance on those activities which are not beneficial and do not serve a shara'i purpose. He says all of those are haram. And so these would be activities which are merely entertainment and nothing constructive comes out of them. So for example, if you play sports, it may not serve a shara'i purpose, but it is constructive because it's good for your health, and looking after your health is something which is in the spirit of the Sharia, and certainly it is permissible and even recommended to look after yourself. But there are many other types of activities like these board games and card games and many others which do not benefit you in any particular way, and they are merely entertainment for the sake of entertainment. Shaykh al-Islam says that these are haram. So obviously, a strict opinion, other scholars would say that this would be a haram if it distracts you from the remembrance of Allah Jalla wa'ala. So if you do it too often or it takes up too much of your time, so this would be haram on the grounds of time wasting. But in any case, whichever opinion you opt for, you can see that the issue is serious and you need to pay attention to it. These activities must not distract you from the remembrance of Allah, and certainly it must not take up much of your time.
There is a weak hadith in Sunan Abi Dawud which says that all types of distractions are null and void and batil except three. Number one, a man training with his horse. Number two, a man shooting his arrow. And number three, a man socializing with his family. So the point is, we should be engaged in constructive pastimes.
Hadith 1147. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من أدخل فرسا بين فرسين وهو لا يأمن أن يسبقه فلا بأس به فإن أمن فهو قمار رواه أحمد وأبو داود وإسناده ضعيف. From Abu Huraira, the Prophet is reported to have said, whoever enters a horse between two horses, so this is a horse race, and he is not sure whether he will win or not, then there is no problem in this. As for if he is sure that he will win, then this is gambling. The hadith is da'if. Some of the scholars have said that when it comes to horse racing, so let's say if we have three people racing and they each put money in the pot, then some scholars say that this would be gambling unless we have a muhallil, somebody who makes this halal. And this would be the third person who does not put anything in the pot. Ibn al-Qayyim says that this is not a condition because it is clearly not fair. And this type of activity was not known from the Sahaba. They used to have horse races, and this was not known. He also says that this hadith is not the wording of the Prophet. Rather, he says this is the wording of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, who is one of the Tabi'een. But what this narration is saying is that if this third person enters the race, and he is sure that he's going to win, so maybe he's definitely got a faster horse than the other two, then this is gambling. It is not clear how this is gambling, because gambling is when one person wins at the expense of the other, or he could lose at the gain of the other. But this person is definitely going to win at the expense of the other. So maybe it is gambling in the sense that with gambling, you are consuming other people's wealth without due right from the Sharia. And with this type of situation, he's also usurping or consuming other people's wealth without due right, because he knows his horse is going to win. So this is a type of cheating. Rather, the race needs to be fair, of course. So if gambling is earning money in a haram way, then in this scenario also, even though it is not exactly like gambling, but it is still earning your money in a haram way. Hadith 1148, وعن عقبة بن عامر رضي الله عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو على المنبر يقرأ وأعد لهم ما استطعت من قوة ومن رباط الخيل الآية ألا إن القوة الرمي ألا إن القوة الرمي ألا إن القوة الرمي رواه مسلم. From Uqba ibn Amir, he says that he heard the Prophet reciting the ayah on the minbar, and prepare for them whatever you can from power and from the steeds of war. The Prophet said about this ayah, verily the strength or the power is the archery, and he said this a total of 3 times. Muslim reported it. We immediately take from this hadith that certainly Muslims have tawakkul on Allah Jalla wa Ala, but tawakkul against your enemies doesn't just mean that you sit back and rely upon Allah, but rather it means you undertake the necessary means which are within your capability. And so this is why Allah says that prepare for them whatever you can from your strength or power and from the steeds of war. Look at how Allah Jalla wa Ala leaves it general. He simply says quwwa, which is strength. And this strength differs from time to time, place to place. So back then, the strength would have been primarily in the archery, but nowadays nobody fights with bows and arrows. You have guns nowadays. So today we would say that the power lies in the various types of guns and other technology. So this is what the Muslims must prepare as a means of war against the enemy. And if the power is archery, as the Prophet said, then it would therefore follow that it is legislated to learn archery. Or at least in those times, it would have been legislated to learn archery. Nowadays, we can say it is just as important to learn how to use a gun, or a machine gun, or a sniper rifle. Because a sniper rifle is just like the archery. Because with the archery, you don't have rapid fire, as you do with the light machine gun or assault rifles. You have a single shot, and you aim from far away. And this is just how a sniper rifle works. We also find from this hadith that the deen of al-Islam is not just merely your aqidah and ritual act of worship. Rather, it is an active deen in which all parts of your life are involved, including military. So it gives guidance on all parts of life. Walhamdulillah. We also find that when it comes to jihad, then defensive jihad is not the only type of jihad at all. Rather, we have the offensive jihad as well. The clear-cut evidence of this has preceded us, with the narration where the Prophet is giving advice to the military leader. But also, and perhaps a little less directly from this narration also, Allah Jalla wa Ala is telling us to prepare for them whatever you can of your power. So this is before you set off for the fighting. And hence this would be the offensive jihad. As for the steeds of war, then there is no doubt that the Sharia holds them in high regard. Allah Jalla wa Ala takes precisely 5 sentences in the Quran, taking an oath by the steeds of war. وَالْعَادِيَاتِ ضَبْحًا فَالْمُورِيَاتِ قَدْحًا فَالْمُغِيرَاتِ صُبْحًا فَأَثَرْنَ بِهِ نَقَعًا فَوَسَطْنَ بِهِ جَمْعًا. All of these 5 sentences taking an oath by the steeds of war and its descriptions. And this is because the steeds of war back then were invaluable to the success of the fighting. Likewise, we have in the Sahihain, Jarir ibn Abdullah, he says that he saw the Prophet twisting the forelock of a horse with his fingers, and he said,
الخيل معقود بنواصيها الخير إلى يوم القيامة.
The forelock of the horse is tied with goodness up till يوم القيامة. And the goodness which he's talking about here is the reward for fighting on them in the jihad, and also the ghanima which you will gain because of you fighting on them. So there cannot be any doubt that the Sharia holds the steeds of war in high regard. As for archery, then clearly you can see from this narration it is held in high regard as well. The Prophet said that this is power. Of course, this is not the only type of power, but it is the main type of power, because archers are invaluable to the army. And this is an example of giving a tafsir of the Quran using a particular example. And you would find this often amongst the tafsir of the Salaf, They would give a tafsir of a particular ayah using a particular example. It does not mean to say that this is the only example to be given for this tafsir, but rather when you give an example, it illustrates the point being made in the ayah. So we cannot say that archery is the only form of power, absolutely not, but it is simply an example of power. We find in the Sunan, the Prophet ﷺ said that for one arrow, Allah Jalla wa'ala will admit three people into Jannah. Firstly, the one who makes this arrow, desiring reward from Allah. Secondly, the one who stabs with this arrow in the way of Allah and he kills the enemy. And thirdly, the one who throws this arrow in the way of Allah Jalla wa'ala. And he went on to say, Irmu warqabu wa antarmu khayrul lakum min antarqabu. Throw and ride, and for you to throw is better for you than to ride. This particular hadith, however, is da'if, but he did say authentically, كُلُّ شَيْءٍ لَيْسَ مِنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ فَهُوَ لَهْوٌ إِلَّا مِنْ أَرْبَعِ خِصَالٍ مَشِي رَجُلْ بَيْنَ غَرَضَيْنِ وَتَأْدِيبِهِ فَرَسَهُ وَمُلَاعَبَتِهِ أَهْلَهُ وَتَعَلُّمِ السِّبَاحَةِ Every activity which does not have the dhikr of Allah, then this is futile and just useless, except four types. A man walking in between the targets, meaning archery practice. A man training his horse. And a man playing with his wife and learning how to swim. So we learn from this hadith to occupy yourself with activities which are useful and constructive. Likewise, authentically he said, مَنْ رَمَى بِالسَّحْمٍ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ فَهُوَ لَهُ عَدْلُ مُحَرَّرٍ Whoever throws an arrow in the way of Allah, then this would gain him the same reward as freeing a servant. Also in Sahih Muslim we find the Prophet saying, مَنْ عَلِمَ الرَّمْيَ ثُمَّ تَرَكَهُ فَلَيْسَ مِنَّا أَوْ قَدْ عَصَى Whoever knows how to throw, meaning an arrow or a spear, and then he leaves it off, then he is not from us, or he said that he has disobeyed. And so like we said before, archery and throwing arrows and spears, they don't really have too much of a role to play nowadays. So we would treat the guns and other projectiles
the same way as archery. So the sunnah is not archery per se. The sunnah is to know how to fire weapons, which would be useful in warfare. That is the sunnah. So it is sunnah to be able to know how to fire an M60 machine gun, for example. Okay, let's take some review questions. Question number one. What is the punishment for killing a mu'ahad? Question number two. State the three types of competitions and the ruling of putting money in the pot for each type. Question number three. During times when horses and camels and archery is not used in warfare, then discuss whether we can hold gambling competitions for these events.